Hey, everybody. I am Jimmy Roberts. Let me just start by saying to the Moon family, to the Suarez family, to the Perry family, as the son of a man who served this country on foreign soil in a war, thank you. What an honor it is to be here tonight with you. So, aside from the fact that I'm a New Yorker who's grateful for the bravery of those who serve and protect us, what am I doing here? Well, there's something else. Let me start and connect a few dots. Steve Stuart and I have known each other for, I don't know, probably 15 years. Can't remember if we met through golf, which would have made some sense, or our kids' sports, which would have also made some sense. Anyway, about 5 years ago, he introduced me to his fellow Answer the Call board member, Mark Messier. From there, Mark and I went on to write a book together. So between Messier and Stuart, I got a good education about a great organization. And in the process, I've also had a front row seat to understand what exactly it is that commitment looks like. I've come to know Steve as one of the most focused people that I have ever come across. And I, by the way, have spent my entire adult life covering successful, driven people. Whether it's Steve's family or his work, or his fitness, or his golf, Steve is all in. And I've also come to understand that it's no different when it comes to helping look after the people who look after us. You know, I'm kind of curious by nature. My wife Sandy, who's here with me tonight, actually says that I don't have conversations with people, I interview them, because that's what I do. I was with Steve the other day and I asked him, I said, it feels like you're involved in a million different types of philanthropy, but is there something different about Answer the Call? It wasn't a long explanation and it wasn't very complicated. He said, I remember one situation where our check was the difference between a family having a nice Christmas and not. And we heard that in the video just a moment ago. We are helping the people who are left behind, and there is nothing like this. Now, we are all here tonight because of Le Grand Orange. Steve, I know that you knew Rusty very well, and I'm sure he's up there tonight raising a glass of wine to you. And if I know Rusty, I'm sure it's a very, very good glass of wine. Burgundy, probably. I'm sure he was thrilled to have you as part of his team and how proud he must be of you tonight. And with that, let me bring up Phil Moyles. Phil?
I am a very, very big fan of Steve Stuart. He asked me about this organization, started participating, said he really, really wanted to get involved. And he said the other philanthropic organization he was involved with at the time didn't have the right focus. So Jimmy's right, it's all about focus. I'm all about taking a look at the past so you can take a look at the future. Most people don't know this, but Steve Stuart grew up in Montana. And I'd like you to watch the screens. You guys pulling that up for me, please? There we go. For those of you who know the show Yellowstone, that is Kevin Costner et al. John Dutton. Steve grew up in Great Falls, found his way to the East Coast, went to Exeter, Columbia. He met his beautiful, wonderful wife, and the only reason he is where he is because of her. She's world class. They've been together since they went to Columbia. The thing about Steve, when you hear about focus, it's all about plow the road. I met him at the Rye Grill and Bar in 2012. And he went about a plan for a golf club we belong to, and he drove it. And I was happy to participate in it, which included getting Jimmy to come on board. When he went about this charity, it was total focus, plow the road. But I'm going to be frank, he's John Dutton. So sometimes he feels that he might know better. He's usually right. And when he goes about it that way, he'll take all the risk to get it done. I've really enjoyed getting to know him, getting to know his family, his lovely wife. He has dug in on this charity, raises funds, participates, gets it done on our executive committee, on the investment committee. He gets it. He also loves New York. And all I have to say to everyone in this room is you are the silent majority and you have spoken tonight. So I would like to say to Steve Stuart, thank you for joining this organization. Thank you for being a great friend. But most of all, thank you for plowing the road. Like John Dutton, you are Yellowstone. Please come up.
I guess I forgot my cowboy hat. Thank you, Jimmy. Thank you, Phil. And thank you to everyone in this room, you know, and the people who gave and who couldn't be here. Thank you to them as well. I'd also like to thank the Gala co-chairs, Bill Ackman, Dean DeColius, Dave Cody, Todd Waterman, Ed Schuyler, and Phil Moyles. I'd also like to thank the board of Answer the Call, as well as the staff that we have. They work hard, and this is always a great event, so thank you. I'm honored to receive the Rusty Staub Award. It's named after a man that I admired, respected, and called a friend. During my time on the board of Answer the Call, I got to know him very well. And since he retired from Major League Baseball in 1985, he poured his time and energy into helping others. He obviously founded this organization in 1985, but he also founded the Rusty Staub Foundation that worked with Catholic charities to feed the hungry and the homeless. He was always helping others. One of my favorite Rusty stories took place in 2015. He was supposed to come over to the house and serve dinner to my wife and I and to the Moyles and the Danhausers. The only problem is he'd had a heart attack a couple weeks before, and I called Rusty and I said, look, let's just postpone this. He wanted to have nothing of it. If anyone in this room knew Rusty, they knew that he was very stubborn. So, shows up at the house, he's got a bunch of groceries. He's looking pretty tired. He's looking more pale than usual. And he starts going to work, making dinner. So I'm thinking, holy shit, I'm gonna have Rusty Staub, you know, have a relapse here and I gotta call 911 or worse. So I'm begging him to take a break, sit down. Of course, you know, being the stubborn Rusty that he was, he didn't. So I had to resort to bribery. So I walked into the wine cellar. I get a really nice, expensive bottle of Burgundy, because Rusty loved Burgundy. And now he was okay to take a break. So I pour some wine, and we're sitting at the kitchen counter. And I said, Rusty, I've got a little story about this bottle of wine. So he goes, okay, let's hear it. So I said, last year at the Rusty Staub Foundation wine auction, and he had a very famous wine auction every year, I said, I sat at a table next to Larry Schloss, fellow board member, and Larry points out that Eddie Milstein is sitting at the table behind us, and he said, Eddie always buys all of the really expensive, hard-to-get Burgundy. So armed with this information, I start making sure that Eddie is paying up for every one of those lots. So I am bidding, and like clockwork, Eddie's the takeout. So we're 10 or 11 lots, you know, in, and I'm putting my hand up, and Rusty looks at me, and he says, sold to you. So I turn around, where's Eddie? So I asked Larry, what happened? He said, oh, he had another dinner obligation, he had to leave. I'm like, Larry, you could have told me that 5 minutes ago. So now Le Grand Orange, he's laughing, some of the color's coming back into his face. And he says to me, he said, you know, don't look at it like you paid a lot of money for some wine. Look at it like what you did helped people who were less fortunate. That's how we thought about the world. So thank you, Rusty. Thank you, everyone.